It was on one of the journeys of my youth. The wind was my travel agent. My thumb pointed at my general destination. Easy come, easy go, then homesickness. Hit you in the stomach like a sucker punch. But there I was on the streets of Seattle, Washington, ready to go home with my tail tucked between my legs and no means to get there. Analyzing the audit of my return to Arkansas fund, the balance had not risen much farther than zero. I was directly aligned on an opposite coast from a year or two earlier. I noticed these people in New York City. That's back before there was crack, meth, and all that, and back before there were gangs, back before the word homeless was even a word. But there was these mysterious street people, and I was quite fascinated. I thought it was a lifestyle choice, and I was curious. I didn't know it then, but within 18 months, I'd be among these people on the opposite coast. His name was Walla Walla Willie, or at least that's the name I gave him. His story was he'd come home from work early one day because he'd been ill and caught his wife in bed with her preacher. Not to make a long story out of this part, but the wife dies of a gunshot wound. Preacher becomes a short-legged big shoe preacher. And Willie gets a 30-year stint at Walla Walla Prison in Washington State. Now retired from his correctional career, he would reside upon the benches late at night at Seattle's Pioneer Square. Now Willie, he was a connoisseur of screw cap wine. Port was his expertise. He showed me how to savor the corner of wine. That's when you done drank the whole bottle and you turn it at 45 degrees and you get this triangulation of wine in the bottom. And you hold it away from your body and you take just a moment to appreciate what you've done and then slam it down. Well, Willie thought I was the greatest because I'd always come up with another $2 to get another bottle. At this point, I had to tell him, you know, I'm all tapped out. Then I asked him, I wonder where a guy could get some work around here. And he said, there's this bus that shows up about 4:30 every morning over there by the Gessler. They get off and they come back with money, he said. So the next morning, a few hours later, I'm standing in front of the Gessler Hotel, which had accommodations that the rats complain about. And sure enough, these two buses showed up. Not having an understanding of the protocol, immediately, there's this great rush for the first bus that caught me flat-footed. Left me with the shufflers boarding the second bus. It was still dark, and it's a foggy northwest, and the streets of Seattle were soon distant. Pretty soon, this little skinny white guy stood up in front of the bus, and he said there'd be no drinking, smoking, or even feeling good until we get to work. I look over my right, and there's already this one guy. He's unscrewing his little bottle, and another guy's rolling smoke. And after a long while, the bus came to a halt. Me and my fellow indigents, we filed off, and there stood that little guy with a clipboard asking our names, and I don't know why I said Barstow Daggett. It was quite light, but not quite dark. There was this thing out in the field. It couldn't quite make it out. It kind of looked like an aircraft in its landing approach. With all its lights, and before I knew it, all these guys took off running for those lights out there. Well, I was young, quite surprised. I passed them all, blowing through them like a Kenyan in the old drunk 5K. I broke the tape. I'm standing before this behemoth of a tractor with two long appendages sticking out from each side, and upon each appendage, there was like eight ironing boards. And they perched about a foot above the ground. Pretty soon, second, third, fourth, eighth plates came in, and they started jumping on the ironing boards, and so I jumped on one, too. 17th, 18th, 19th, they came in, and they had to get a bucket and walk behind. Now, it was really getting light out. I could kind of tell what was going on. There was this valley surrounded by mountains. It's wet fog of the Pacific Northwest was kind of clinging to the side of the hills. And before me, there was this expanse of green row crops. Well, I kind of figured it out. We're fixing to pick something. With the team assembled, the track started to move. And I remember the girl driving the tractor saying, "Remember, no bigger than your hand, you got to get the little ones." The tractor started gliding at half a mile an hour over this humongous cucumber field. He had to grab the little ones, stuff them in this hole underneath your ironing board, and the little pickles would go up this conveyor belt and drop into this big container on the tractor. Once in a while, someone on the ironing board would fall asleep. His arm be dragging through the crops, and guys with the buckets would shout him out, and the first one to notice would get to replace him. Anyway, I was steadily stuffing these little pickles in the hole. And I don't know if you've ever picked cucumbers in any quantity. You don't want to do this without gloves. My hands were shredded. They're one spiny vegetable. With my hands hurting, feeling really awful, this land craft came to a halt. And up drove a truck. It's one of those kind of stainless steel concessions trucks with a big pot of stew on board. They served it up in styrofoam cups, and I was slamming them down as fast as they could fill them. I hadn't eaten in days. On the other side of the stand, you could get gloves and other things. So after consuming several cups of this delicious stew, I had a warm belly, a pair of rubber gloves, and it was all there for the taking. I was so grateful. The rest of the day was much easier. At the end of the day, the bus pulls back up, and we all got in line. The same old skinny white man with a clipboard was going down the line. He said to me, "Daggett, Barstow, you ate 8 cups of stew and bought a pair of gloves. Ready to pay $25, you get $3.50. It was a long bus ride back to Seattle. I was nursing my wounds, but savoring that bottle of beer they gave each of us. So that evening, I was explaining to Walla Walla Willie what I'd gone through and what they'd done to me, and he said, "You got paid how much?" I said, $3.50. He looked at me, grinned. He said, "I got 50 cents. That's 2 bottles. We good?"